As we come to worship God today, I want to share with us some words from Isaiah the prophet. He says, "Give thanks to the Lord, call on his name, make known among the nations what he has done, and proclaim that his name is exalted. Sing to the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world. Shout aloud and sing for joy, people of Zion, for great is the Holy One of Israel among you." Let's stand and sing. Let's pray to God together. Lord God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, the perfect Trinity, the one who is indivisibly merciful and mighty, perfect in power, love, and purity. As we approach you today, we join with the chorus of heaven, as the angels around your throne praise you endlessly and perfectly, and we add our voices to the chorus, "Holy, holy, holy." For God, there is none like you, majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. We praise you for all your works, for your mind-blowing act of creation, for your infinitely wise sustaining of this world, for how you have and do and will shape history according to your perfect plans. And most of all, Lord, we praise you for your greatest work, the work of salvation. That, Father, in love you sent the Son. That, Jesus, you came to be a perfect Savior of a hopeless world. That, Holy Spirit, you empowered Jesus to live perfectly, die in our place, and you rose him again so that a sinful, rebellious humanity might know your rescue and redemption. What love, what favor, what kindness has been shown to us by you, the Almighty. Help us today to grasp the height and breadth and length and depth of your love for us in Christ and the great hope that is ours who believe in him. Help us to reflect all our thankfulness, all our praise, all our joy in these things to you, the God who is our Savior and Redeemer, the everlasting Lord. Amen. Well, let's share together in this prayer of confession on the screen and in the sheet. Our Father and God, we are people who do not worship you with everything as we ought. We often turn from your goodness and love towards false and fleeting idols. This dishonors you and diminishes our lives. We are sorry and we long to change. Help us, Lord Jesus. Break in and capture our idol-chasing hearts by your grace. Turn our hearts from earthly treasures that we might make you our true treasure. Help us to glory in you and your finished work at the cross on our behalf. Help us to hate the sin, but wonder at the love that took you there. Amen. And as we confess our sin, we can be encouraged, because Jesus said, "It is not the healthy who need a doctor, but the sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners." Let's stand again and sing, "O Lord, our Rock and our Redeemer."
Thank you.
Our first reading today is from Mark's Gospel and a selection of verses from chapter 15, and Anne is going to come and read it to us.
Very early in the morning, the chief priests with the elders, the teachers of the law, and the whole Sanhedrin reached a decision. They bound Jesus, led him away, and turned him over to Pilate. "Are you the king of the Jews?" asked Pilate. "Yes, it is as you say," Jesus replied. The chief priests accused him of many things. So again Pilate asked him, "Aren't you going to answer? See how many things they are accusing you of." But Jesus still made no reply, and Pilate was amazed. Now, verse 22, they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. Then they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it, and they crucified him. Dividing up his clothes, they cast lots to see what each would get. It was the third hour when they crucified him. The written notice of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews." They crucified two robbers with him, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by hurled insults at him, shaking their heads and saying, "So, you who are going to destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, come down from the cross and save yourself." In the same way, the chief priests and the teachers of the law mocked him among themselves. "He saved others," they said, "but he can't save himself. Let this Christ, this King of Israel, come down now from the cross, that we may see and believe." Those crucified with him also heaped insults on him. At the sixth hour, darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour. And at the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And verse 37, with a loud cry, Jesus breathed his last. The curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And when the centurion who stood there in front of Jesus heard his cry and saw how he died, he said, "Surely this man was the Son of God." Amen.
Thanks, Anne. Let's pray again together. Lord Jesus, we have already sung of what an amazing Saviour you are. We have gloried in your cross as we've confessed our sin. And yet, as we come to you again, we just want to thank and praise you for that wonderful work you have achieved. As we read again of those verses, as we see the suffering you endured, we praise you, for you did this for us who were your enemies, us who were unlovely, us who were the least deserving. And yet, to you, we have been loved. To you, we have been worthy. To you, we have been crowned with grace. And so, Lord Jesus, we ask and continue to ask that as a people, as your people, you would help us to be shaped by the grace that has been shown to us and is shown to us. We ask that as a church, you would help us to grow in that grace together, that you would fill us up in our experience of your love and kindness and mercy, that it might overfill and spill over, not just into our daily lives, but into all that we meet. As we look ahead to the new term and see the activities laid out on the term card, we're so thankful, Lord Jesus, for all the different activities we have as a church, all the different ways in which we might express our thankfulness of you, share your good news, and encourage one another in the faith. We ask that each one of these activities would be ones where you are at the center and for which your Father would receive glory and praise and honor. We also ask that as the Kirk Session and Outreach team meet this week, that you would help them both as they meet to discuss issues and plan going forward. Give them wisdom, insight. Give them help and grace in the midst of their decisions. Lord Jesus, just as you have lavished your grace upon us, so we ask for your help that we might share the good news of your grace with this community. Just as you love the least and the lost, help us to do the same. And Lord Jesus, it is then with this in mind, we do want to pray for our community. We pray for those who are most looked down upon. We ask that whether it is because of their material poverty or their past or their present, you would help us to draw alongside and show your love. That you would help us to draw alongside and welcome them to the one who is the friend of sinners. We thank you too for the different provision in our society for folks who need help, and we pray for your ongoing common grace to help those who work with those who are facing addictions and illness in mind or body, the different support services that are part of the NHS and the charity sector. We ask that you would give them help day by day as they try and help folks who are the least and obviously most forgotten. Lord Jesus, we also want to pray for our schools, and we thank you for this new term that started. We ask that you would guide the teachers and the support staff, and we ask that these places would be places of learning and discovery and good places for the young people of our parish. We pray especially for young folks who are facing anxieties or bullies or are being bullied. Lord God, would you help them and draw near them? Would you somehow find a way for the goodness of your love to shine into their lives, that they might know that in Christ they can be loved and accepted? We pray these things for Jesus' sake. Amen. Well, we're coming to our second Bible reading now, and in a moment or two, Rob is going to read it to us. It's 1 Kings 18, 16 to 46. 1 Kings 18, 16 to 46. I just want to give two or three sentences, well, four or five sentences of introduction to it, just to remind us where we are in the story. We're turning again to the life and times of Elijah. And this week, what we have is probably the most famous, the most exciting, the most dramatic part of the whole story. It's not quite the end of the story, but it is the bit we've all been waiting for. Because up until this point, the tension has been rising. We've been seeing that God, sorry, the king and the people have turned from God to Baal. And through the prophet Elijah, God has been mounting this counterattack. A drought was announced, a chastisement on the people, and a direct challenge to Baal. Now, we've seen Elijah off in Zarephath showing us that the Lord is God, not Baal. And now he's back in Israel. We really want him to show everyone that. We want everyone to see that the Lord is God and Baal is not. And so here we are at this great moment of confrontation. And we wait with anticipation to see what God will do.
So Obadiah went to meet Ahab and told him, and Ahab went to meet Elijah. When he saw Elijah, he said to him, "Is that you, you troubler of Israel?" "I have not made trouble for Israel," Elijah replied, "but you and your father's family have. You have abandoned the Lord's commands and have not followed, and you have followed the Baals. Now summon the people from all over Israel to meet me on Mount Carmel. And bring the 450 prophets of Baal and the 400 prophets of Asherah who eat at Jezebel's table." So Ahab sent word throughout all Israel and assembled the prophets on Mount Carmel. Elijah went before the people and said, "How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. But if Baal is God, follow him." The people said nothing. Then Elijah said to them, "I am the only one of the Lord's prophets left, but Baal has 450 prophets. Get two bulls for us. Let Baal's prophets choose one for themselves, and let them cut it into pieces and put it on the wood, but not set fire to it. I will prepare the other bull and put it on wood, but not set fire to it. Then you call on the name of your God, and I will call on the name of the Lord. The God who answers by fire, he is God." Then all the people said, "What you say is good." Elijah said to the prophets of Baal, "Choose one of the bulls and prepare it first, since there are so many of you. Call on the name of your God, but do not light the fire." So they took the bull given them and prepared it. Then they called on the name of Baal from morning till noon. "Baal, answer us," they shouted. But there was no response. No one answered. And they danced around the altar that they had made. At noon, Elijah began to taunt them. "Shout louder," he said. "Surely he is a god. Perhaps he is deep in thought or busy or traveling. Maybe he is sleeping. He must be awakened." So they shouted louder and they slashed themselves with swords and spears, as was their custom, until their blood flowed. Midday passed and they continued their frantic prophesying until the time for the evening sacrifice. But there was no response. No one answered. No one paid attention. Then Elijah said to all the people, "Come here to me." They came to him, and he repaired the altar of the Lord, which had been torn down. Elijah took 12 stones, one for each of the tribes descended from Jacob, to whom the word of the Lord had come, saying, "Your name shall be Israel." With the stones, he built an altar in the name of the Lord, and he dug a trench around it, large enough to hold 2 seahs of seed. He arranged the wood, cut the bull into pieces, and laid it on the wood. Then he said to them, fill 4 large jars with water and pour it on the offering and on the wood. Do it again, he said, and they did it again. Do it a third time, he ordered, and they did it a third time. The water ran down around the altar and even filled the trench. At the time of sacrifice, the prophet Elijah stepped forward and prayed, Lord, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, let it be known today that you are God in Israel, and that I am your servant, and have done all these things at your command. Answer me, Lord, answer me, so that these people will know that you, Lord, are God, and that you are turning their hearts back again. Then the fire of the Lord fell and burned up the sacrifice, the wood, the stones, and the soil, and also licked up the water in the trench. When the people saw this, they fell prostrate and cried, The Lord, He is God. The Lord, He is God. Then Elijah commanded them, Seize the prophets of Baal. Don't let anyone get away. They seized them, and Elijah had them brought down to Kishon Valley and slaughtered there. And Elijah said to Ahab, Go, eat and drink, for there is a sound of heavy rain. So Ahab went off to eat and drink, but Elijah climbed up to the mount, or the top of Carmel, bent down to the ground, and put his face between his knees. Go and look toward the sea, he told his servant. And he went up and looked. There's nothing there, he said. 7 times, Elijah said, go back. The 7th time the servant reported, a cloud as small as a man's hand is rising from the sea. So Elijah said, go tell Ahab, hitch up your chariot and go down before the rain stops you. Meanwhile, the sky grew black with clouds. The winds rose. A heavy rain started falling, and Ahab rode off to Jezreel. The power of the Lord had came on Elijah, and tucking his cloak into his belt, he ran ahead of Ahab all the way to Jezreel. Amen.
Thanks, Rob. Well, have you ever had that kind of experience where you're watching a film or reading a book and you find yourself just captivated, immersed? I remember a few times watching something like that, a program on TV or a film, and you know, it's so good that you don't let your mind wander. You don't suddenly start thinking, what's for tea? Or look at your phone, or think about what else is going on in life. You just sit and you appreciate a story. And today, basically what I want to do is something a little different to what I normally do when I preach. Usually we go line by line through the passage under headings. Today what I want to do is tell 2 good stories. My hope is it's more like the experience of being captivated and less like the experience I had last night when I tried to watch a film. And Susan and I sat for a long time and eventually we paused it just to see how long was left because we thought it must be finished. And there were still 45 minutes. Hopefully, it won't feel like that. I want to tell the story that Rob has just read and the story of Jesus' crucifixion because actually, I think, they both teach us in some ways the same thing. They teach us that the Lord is God alone and He is the God who calls us to return or repent. So sit back, here's the first story. The odds were stacked against Elijah that day. The battle and contest was uneven. It took place outside of Israel, up a hill, the place named Carmel. It was the place of Baal's power. After all, Baal was supposed to be the god that brought thunder, so where else better to show it off? This was Baal's own territory. The religious establishment were licking their lips. They couldn't believe their luck. It couldn't have been set up any better for them. A simple contest. Who is God? The Lord or Baal? If the fire fell on their altar, and not Elijah's, then all their plans would be complete. That way they could prove that Baal really was the god of thunder and rain, and they could do away with Elijah and this notion of praising the Lord. They could squash the loyalty among the people, and the plans of Queen Jezebel would be complete. The political establishment, however, knew it was a little risky. Even though Ahab addressed Elijah as the troubler of Israel, in his heart of hearts, he is troubled by Elijah's words in the past and presence before him now. Elijah reads the charge to the people. How long will you waver between two opinions? If the Lord is God, follow him. If Baal is God, follow him. The people say nothing. A few hours later, they're all up the hill. The altar to Baal is set. The bull is set upon the wood. But the fire is not set. Now it is time for Baal to act. From morning until noon, the priests of Baal throw everything they can at it. They call on their god. They shout. They dance. They feverishly continue. But nothing. Elijah's contribution at this point, well, he mocks them. What kind of God can't hear fervent worship, he asks. What kind of God goes to the little boy's room or needs a nap or goes off on a trip? The priests continue on into the afternoon. They ceremonially slash themselves, as was their custom. Their blood pours from their wounds. But still nothing. No response. No one answered. No one paid any attention. Baal is no god. And then we're told the time has come. Elijah steps forward. Before everyone present, Ahab, Baal's prophets and the people, Elijah reconstructs God's broken altar. He digs out a moat, he sets up the wood, he lays the sacrifice on it. But because he wants to prove that God is God and no one else, he drenches it all in water. Only supernatural fire will set this alight. And then, a quick, simple prayer. Answer me, so that these people will know that you, the Lord, are God, and that you are turning hearts back to you. And then, dramatically, supernaturally, fire comes and burns up the sacrifice, even the water in the moat. It's plain for all around to see that the Lord is God and God alone. The people fall prostrate before him and cry out, "The Lord is God. The Lord is God." The prophets of Baal don't. They stubbornly still refuse to acknowledge God. And so they must face judgment. Elijah gathers them and puts them to the sword. Elijah approaches the king, and he tells him to go eat and drink. The king is given time by God to reconsider and repent, that he might find mercy, that his destiny might be changed. Further proof of the Lord's power was coming. In the clouds, a storm. Rain would finally fall on the land once again. Elijah sends his servant out to look 6 times and nothing. But then a cloud rises. This would seem the end of the story, but not here. There is a strange, surprising, disturbing end to this story. the power of the Lord comes on Elijah, and he runs. He overtakes the chariot and arrives at Jezreel, there to meet Ahab for a reckoning. Well, as we take a moment to come up for air from that first story, just consider with me, who is like the Lord? Not only was he able to prove himself over and above Baal and all of his 450 prophets, but he did it in such a way that he turned back the hearts of his wayward people. What amazing kindness and mercy he shows, even as he is proving himself. The prophets of Baal are slaughtered, but they're without excuse. They've seen who the Lord is. It's perfect justice. And all this through one man, Elijah. Well, that shows that only God is God. Time for another story. The odds were stacked against Jesus that day. The contest was uneven. It took place outside of a city up a hill, the place named the Skull. This was Satan's territory. The religious establishment were licking their lips. They couldn't believe their luck. It couldn't have been set up any better for them. A simple charge: who is Jesus? The Messiah? If the trials went their way and justice fell, their plans would be complete. This was the way they could prove Jesus was blasphemous and do away with him. They could squash the loyalty among the people, and they could fulfill their own plans. The political establishment, however, does know it's risky. Even though Pilate addresses Jesus as a troubler of the Roman Empire, in his heart of hearts, he's conflicted by Jesus' words. Pilate reads the charge against Jesus. "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus says nothing. A few hours later, they're all up the hill. The three crosses are set and the Lamb of God is laid upon it. Now it is time for God to act. From morning until noon, darkness. People passing by throw everything they can at Jesus. He saved others. He can't save himself. Soldiers mock, and even the other condemned ones hurl insults. Jesus' contribution at this point? He prays for them. What kind of God subjects himself to the sinful anger of humanity, lets himself be killed, and in the face of all of it prays, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they're doing"? What kind of God continues on into the afternoon, blood flowing from his wounds, as no one pays him any attention or worship? There is no God like Jesus. A quick, simple prayer. "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." And then, dramatically, supernaturally, the curtain temple is torn in two. And it is plain for all to see that something happened there. This was no ordinary death. At the cross, fire fell. And Jesus has made the way to God open. one man at the cross bows in his heart and says, surely this was the Son of God. That opportunity is still open today for any heart to bow and say, Jesus is Lord. Jesus is Lord. Those who stubbornly refuse to acknowledge will face judgment, but not yet. There is time now given by God for people as we go about our lives, as we eat and drink. Time to repent. Time for wayward ones to come back. For mercy to be found and eternal destinies to be changed. Further proof of all of this is coming in the clouds. A storm, but not like Elijah's day, in Jesus' final return. His servants look out day by day, hour by hour, for his coming, and for now nothing. But on one unknown day, he will appear in majesty and in glory. God's final vindication, the final judgment will come. For some, eternal life and peace. For others, eternal death and torment. It may seem a strange, disturbing end to the story of the world. But consider this. In the power of the Lord, Jesus has rushed on ahead after his resurrection and up to heaven. And he has poured out his Holy Spirit on his church that we might share the good news of this gospel so that many sinners like us might return, that we might come and find peace, and they might too. So that on that final day, on that final reckoning, many may have eternal life and peace. Well, as we let that story sit with us, and as we come to an end today, consider with me, who is like Jesus? He was able to complete his mission, though everyone was against him. That mission of suffering and dying on the cross at the very humanity who he deserved to judge. What amazing mercy and kindness. Where else in the universe have you seen such love? His call to everyone is to turn away from our sin, come and find peace in him, and trust in him alone as Savior and as Lord. Even if we are people like Elijah's day and we are wayward, he says, come. We may have turned to other gods, other joys, other things. We may have gone off on our own path. We may have turned from him and entangled ourselves in the deceptiveness of sin. We may have hidden ourselves in the darkness of sin. But we can bow again, and we can find full forgiveness. We can find restoration. His mercy is more. He has grace greater than all our sins. His power outruns the wayward and runaway chariots of our obedient hearts. Come to Jesus, who said, all those the Father gives me will come to me, and whoever comes to me I will never drive away. This is the will of him who sent me, that I shall lose none of all those he has given me, but raise them up at the last day. For my Father's will is that everyone who looks to the Son and believes in him will have eternal life, and I will raise them up at the last day. to not bow in our hearts in worship, in adoration, and in trust now would leave us without excuse, like the prophets of Baal. And if we stubbornly refuse him, we will meet him one day as judge, and he has power to condemn us forever. But why would you do it? Now that you see who he is, now that you have heard these stories, now that you see the one who died on the cross for you, return to him if you have turned away. Come to him if you never have. He is the way to the Father. He is the way to peace. He is the way to eternal life. Let's pray together. Lord Jesus, who is like you? Who in this universe has done what you have done? Who has descended so low and also has been raised so high? We thank you that you were brought so low that none of us are below you, but you have been raised so high that you can take any of us with you. We worship and adore you. We thank you for your cross, and we ask that you would give us hearts to love and obey and trust you. Help us to turn away from sin and to know the peace and love and hope that can only be found in you. We pray these things for your sake. Amen. We'll finish our service today by singing "How Great Thou Art."
1, 2, 3, 4. Consider all the worlds thy hands have made. I see the stars, I hear the rolling thunder, thy power throughout the universe displayed. Then sings my soul, my Savior, Son not sparing, sent him to die. I scarce can take it in that on the cross, my burden gladly bearing, he bled and died to take away my sin. And then sings my soul. My soul, my Savior, God, to thee. shall come with shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart? Then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. And then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee, how great thou art, how great.
May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, evermore. Amen.